Hey y'all, it's Harrison here. Welcome to the first episode of 2020. My brother Nick and I have definitely appreciated all the support that everyone's given us over the last seven episodes now. It's been awesome. We love doing it. We love talking about video games and having a platform to kind of talk about them on. Like I said over the past couple of episodes, this is something I've always been wanting to do, and hopefully we can bring it forward and kind of make this podcast into like a really awesome thing, get more guests on and all that good stuff. I would definitely appreciate if you guys could put down those chicky nuggies and pull up your phone or laptop or computer and go into your favorite podcasting platform, whether it's Apple Podcast or Spotify or iHeartRadio, and drop us a review. We would definitely appreciate that. That's probably the best way to support us at the moment. We do have a special guest on this week, and at some point his laptop decided to restart on itself, and so it was probably about 15 minutes or so where he kind of disappeared. So when you hear that, he's not gone. He will be back, and I try to do my best of editing around that little part. Me and Nick did continue on to talk about some games and stuff, and then whenever he came back in, he joined it. So there might be like a little bit of an awkward transition into Trey coming back, but it's all good, and we continue to talk about some games, so it's all good. But yeah, appreciate everyone listening, and on to the show.
All right, guys, welcome to another episode of Gaming with the Bros podcast.
How's it going, guys?
Hello.
We're here with my brother Nick, of course, as always, and our special guest Trey.
What's going on, y'all?
Longtime friend. Happy belated birthday, by the way.
Thanks, man.
Our second guest now. Adam was last time we
recorded. Dude, his voice has gotten so deep.
Yeah, it's probably been a few years since you've seen him.
Yeah, I mean, I don't even know how long it's been since I saw him, but I know like the last time I saw him, he was like super tall, and I was like, what the hell?
Yeah.
And when I heard him on you guys' podcast the other day, I was like, what in the world, man? This guy sounds like a grown-ass man, which I guess he is now.
Yeah.
So, we kind of took about a week and a half off after we did the Game of the Year discussion. So, I think now going forward, we'll get back to that normal every Sunday. So, we'll go ahead and dive right in. There's not a ton of news this week, but with Trey being on, that's good. So, we'll kind of let him talk about some of his favorite games of the year and, what we've been playing. Trey, you want to go ahead and start it off? What you've been playing?
I have been playing, I've been mixing between some things. I was playing Apex Legends for a long time. That was a game that I hated at first because I never understood it. I remember back when Fortnite came out, I played it. I never understood like the building aspect of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I gave up on it. And then when Apex Shadow dropped, I was just like, all right, I'm going to give it a shot. So I gave it a shot, played three matches, deleted it. And I was just like, man, this is not my game. And then I re-downloaded it for whatever reason one Monday. I was just really bored. And then I got to like level 100. And then I was dude, hell yeah.
So, oh my God.
Well, now I recently stopped playing it because they just did an update to where they changed the level cap from 100 to 500.
Oh, wow.
And so the grind is still like, they didn't decrease the amount of XP you need per level. It's still like the same amount. So it just takes forever to level up.
Oh, God, yeah.
And then, it got kind of behind the things where it's like kind of like a pay to win type game.
Mm-hmm.
It's fun, but I just don't get behind that stuff. It's just, I know that's kind of the way some games are going, but
when you say pay to win, I thought it only had like cosmetics and stuff like that you could pay.
There's that stuff. And like when you have like new game modes and stuff, it's only released with like the battle pass. So like for you to pay, which like if you play the battle pass, or you buy it, you get the money back if you complete all the levels of the battle pass, which I'm not sure that's how other ones are. I know like Modern Warfare.
That's how Fortnite is.
Was like that. Yeah. Fortnite has a lot of, I guess I shouldn't say pay to win. It's more like if you want to look cool, you have to pay for it, which to me is like, so I'm going to rewind on what I said because that's definitely not what it is. I was playing Modern Warfare. I just recently deleted that just because when it first came out, man, I was like, that's freaking awesome. But then they came out with the battle pass again. And I was just like, man,
I don't know. Nick talked about a couple weeks ago. It was like literally everything now has a battle pass in it.
I know. It's ridiculous, man.
It's like, I mean, you got all these good multiplayer games, and with every game has a battle pass, it's hard to like pick one, you know? It's like,
yeah,
you gotta commit too.
You buy the battle pass and you want to feel dedicated to that game because you pay for it, so
right. Well, like, it's the things are, they're too expensive, you know? It's like they have like one of the I think one of the most recent things that came out of Modern Warfare was like the Nikto bundle. They had the new operator. And yeah. Like you got like a new gun, and it had like the bullets had like blue tracers. So everyone was like, oh wow, blue tracers. So when you shoot, it shoots like little blue bullet, like electrified little bullets. And it was like 2,400 COD points. Yeah, it's really cool. But then like you look at it and you can only get it with a bundle, and it's 2,400 COD points, which is $19.99. You know, so it's like to pay $60 for a game, and then for you just to look cool for like one, you know, maybe like a week, and then they drop another operator or something.
So that's when I can kind of get behind stuff like Apex Legends, where it's it's free.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, if you're like, hey man, this game's super cool and I want to support the developers, you know, I'll drop a couple bucks, you know,
right?
Get like a silly scanner or a cool looking scanner or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, when it's like Call of Duty and you're paying $60, you know, a pop for these games, plus you're paying $20 for a battle pass, and it's like,
yeah, it's too much. And I mean, like when it first came out, it would have just been fine, you know, like had you just kept it like that and then had like, you know, DLC drop like every other Call of Duty, like, you know, you don't have to have the battle pass, and then like every week have like a new tab where you're just like, oh look, a new operator, oh, a new skin. And it's not just the skin, it's like all this crap that comes with it.
Yeah.
And so you have to pay more for it.
Yeah. It's a lot.
So I delete that. I can tell you though, the game that I've been playing and I have enjoyed the most, and I feel like I've got the most bang on my buck for, was Assassin's Creed Odyssey.
Yeah.
I got that game, and I got the Ultimate Edition, and it was on sale for, it was normally $120, and I got it for $30. And so it also came with Assassin's Creed 3 Remastered.
Ooh,
and
nice.
That, like, and it came with all the DLCs, the story arcs and everything. So that game, I mean, the last time I checked it, I haven't even beaten it. I'm like 90 hours in. Oh, and I mean, God. It's worth it.
I know the president of Ubisoft, what is his name? Something.
Let's bing it.
But he was talking about it, and it was like kind of a more of a recent interview, I guess, but all of our games are kind of going in that model of, you know, really giving value to the players, you know.
Yeah.
Assassin's Creed with these huge open worlds.
Mm-hmm.
Rainbow Six, how much they've been updating that game.
Siege or whatever?
Yeah, and then Ghost Recon. I know the newest one hasn't got the best of raps, but it's still along that line of, you know, these big open worlds where, you know, you're going to be able to play for months and months because they're constantly updating it. And, you know,
right.
Really
always have the outline.
Yeah, it's got an outline of, you know, what's going on.
I feel like Wildlands was like that. Like, it had, like, a bad rap when it first came out. But then, like, after that, it became, like, everyone's like, dude, this game fucking rocks.
Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of games that are like that. It's like they get released
too early,
not great, and then, like, it takes time.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I
– even
– if I play a game, and especially if I bought it, like, I pay $60 for this thing, and it comes out, and it sucks. And then they're like, oh, just – We'll in 6 months it's gonna be fixed, we promise. And then it's like, well, 6 months later I'm probably not playing this game anymore.
Right, like, because you're gonna like to the next thing that might be coming out or whatever. Yeah. So it destroys trust with like the consumer. So I mean, I totally understand that.
Yeah,
that happened with Siege too. I think that was kind of panned at first, but now like
a lot of people love it. I like that, like the Division. I think the Division
Destiny too
better, but. Destiny. I mean, gosh, I hated that game. I hated Destiny so much. I mean, I can't even.
Dude, it's free now.
Yeah, it's free to play now.
Yeah. Well, I did play it the other, like when it first went free to play, and it's a cool game. Like the shooting's super cool.
Dude, the online, the multiplayer, badass. Like,
yeah, multiplayer, I mean, is really cool.
Yeah, it's fun. Like the story, you know, I can give two craps about, but dude, the online, I mean, it's not Halo. But it's like your best remedy if you don't have Halo.
Yeah, I mean, it's same developer. So, I mean, the shooting was always like the best part of that game. There's just nothing else in that game.
I just couldn't. Yeah. I can't care about the story. Like, I can't care less. You know, it's just.
Okay, it's just like it's a wild goose chase. It just has you go on one place to another, and then.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah.
Tough things about games like that, like when they're trying to go for that MMO route.
Mm-hmm.
because the stories aren't ever great. Like,
well, because there's too much shit.
Yeah, like, I know there's like a really deep lore with like World of Warcraft and stuff, and those stories are cool. But I don't know, just Destiny doesn't have that story that, you know, WoW has, or, you know, these other, you know, Final Fantasy or something. It's just not.
Yeah.
So you picked WoW and Final Fantasy as games with good stories? Is that what you're sticking with?
I could care less about WoW's story, but I know that a lot of people do care about like the lore and history of those games and stuff. Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I played it for like 9 years, and I mean, I never really understood what I was doing. I mean, each time, and that was like one of the things with that I was going to say earlier. Like, WoW was like one of those things where it's kind of like you don't have to pay for stuff, but like, you would do raids through like a certain expansion, and then like you would just feel so awesome about yourself. And then literally like the next update would come out, which was like free for everybody. And then the starting armor for like the next update would like obliterate the one that you just spent like 10 hours trying to get in a raid. And see that, yeah, like stuff like that, like I don't understand.
Yeah, that's the unfortunate thing about those games, is they always, all that time and energy you spent.
It's like pointless. The next
expansion comes out and it just blows everything else out of the water.
This sucks.
And kind of going back to COD, like I wish, like the skins you unlock. Like, I know they have camos that you can unlock for getting like a certain amount of kills, but I wish they were a testament to your like actual skills rather than how much you pay.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. Like, that's what I don't get. Like, I mean, if I read correctly, like a long time ago, they got rid of like supply drops because it became like gambling or something was like a big deal. So but like at the same time, like, it's not gambling if you don't have to use real money. Just create supply drops in the game and like figure out a formula for you to just earn it and use it, you know, like what was it, Rocket League, they just recently changed their whole thing. Like, you had to win crates, and then once you win crates, you had to buy keys. So it's like,
which was ridiculous.
But. Right. And so now they changed it to blueprints. So now you like unlock the blueprint, and then you get credits, and you have to unlock what you just unlocked by buying the blueprint. Like, it's stupid. Like, it makes you feel like, oh, sweet, I got this for free. But like, how do you get credits? Well, you don't earn them in game. You have to buy them. Yeah. It's the same thing. Like, and I don't get that. Like, I mean, I get like when you create like a free game, which Rocket League I got for free when I first played. It was like a PlayStation Plus thing.
Yeah.
But as far as I know, like, it wasn't a free game when it first came out.
No. I know, because that's when I first started playing this, because it went free on PlayStation.
Yeah.
No, I think it came to Game Pass for Xbox at some point, but other than that, it's not free.
Yeah, and it's like, I get they need money to, like, keep producing content, but I don't know.
At some point,
they could do it better.
Right. It's just like the whole like Capcom gimmick, where like someone gets a Capcom game and then they fucking data mine it, and then like they find like all these things that are actually on the disc, but you have to buy the code to unlock it that's already on the disc. Like, why are we paying more for?
Yeah, that used to be a real big problem. I feel like back in the day too, it's like that, you know, the quote unquote day one DLC or whatever.
Yeah.
And then you get the code and it's like 10 megabytes, and you're like, hold on.
Doesn't make.
Yeah, hold on. Could this just not have been on the disc? Like,
you're really just
unlocking this feature as a pre-order bonus. Like, come on.
It doesn't make sense. Or like, you know, like Nick, like how we're talking about like Modern Warfare, like make it to where like if you want to unlock like a certain skin for a character, you have to use that character and you have to do something with that character. Like,
right.
Get so many different ribbons or something, and this and that, or so many different things. But. And then, like, the whole thing with the season, like, when the season goes and you level up from, like, 155 or from 55 to 155, it just goes back to 55.
Yeah.
You know, like, it doesn't.
Yeah, I know you don't prestige
it. It just doesn't matter.
Yeah, like, it doesn't matter because all your shit's unlocked. Like, prestiging used to be cool because, like, you'd have to reset. And that's how you would find out, like, all these different guns you were good with, because at least that's how I played. Like, I would play, like, a playthrough and get to 55, and then I would reset, and then I would never use the gun that I used the first time around. And I'll keep changing.
Yeah, you want to learn a new gun that might be cooler or whatever?
Right. So, but it's like, when you do that, it doesn't do it.
I haven't played the new Call of Duty. So is it – because I remember back in the day, you would use a specific gun, and then you would unlock camo and stuff for getting headshots and whatever.
Right.
That's still the case.
You would unlock attachments and stuff like that. Is that still the same thing?
It's still the same thing. But this one is, like, crazy. Like, I don't know what the last like Call of Duty that you played is, but this one you have like, I don't even know. Like, I like the only gun I've like leveled up all the way was the M4A1, and it had 71 levels.
Jeez.
And it's literally you unlock an attachment every level. But I mean, like, I mean, Nick, you can attest to this. Like, half of them are scopes.
Yeah, like, half of them are scopes, and then half of them are kind of useless.
Yeah, like, or like perks. Like, a perk is like an attachment in this game, and then like, the scopes, literally, they just have two versions of themselves. They'll have like an American version, and then like I think like a Russian version or something like that. But it's technically the same thing. It just looks slightly different.
Mm-hmm.
And like, I mean, it makes it cool because like, you know, certain guns can become other guns by the way you modify them. You can change like ammunition that goes in them, all this stuff, which that's really cool. But yeah. I think I've come to learn, like, as I've grown older, I think about nostalgia, and I'm like, man, like, I can't believe they're remaking like Modern Warfare. Like, this is gonna be crazy. This game was like, you know, iconic when we first played it. But at the same time, you're just remaking another formula that is like 10 years old. And so it still feels 10 years old.
Yeah.
And it, I don't know. I think I got bored of it like a month after I played it. And that's why I deleted it. I was like, dude, screw this. So I just recently bought Spider-Man. So.
Ah, nice. Cool. Yeah. Yeah, I went to play Black Friday for like $15, I think.
Yeah, yeah, they had it on PlayStation just now for $20 Game of the Year edition. So I was like, well, I'm gonna get that.
Yeah, I'm about maybe a couple hours into it. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, it was either that or Resident Evil 2, and I'll let my wife decide.
Resident Evil 2, man. Ooh.
Yeah, I know. I downloaded the demo yesterday, and I actually played it this morning. And okay. Dude, that shit.
Yeah, it's cool. I can't wait for 3.
Yeah, like, I hope they remake 4 like that. I know it's been ported to every system.
Yeah,
everything. But if they remake 4,
probably a couple of years.
What are they gonna do to it though? Like, are they? I mean, because how are they gonna update it where it feels modern? Besides just making it where you can move and aim in the same.
True, way. Because Resident Evil 4, it plays like
it was like the big step.
Yeah, right.
Make 4, like, yeah, I would want like the control style of 2, and then obviously 3 going
forward. It goes backwards and becomes like a fixed camera.
But like, that just sucks.
Maybe like completely redo it. You know, maybe mix it up, or I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, you're right, Nick. I didn't even think about that because I forgot that was like the transition.
Yeah,
which is why it was so good. So I mean. But I know, like, you know, the only thing they could change is that, you know, you couldn't aim and shoot. You had or run and aim. You could only stay still. Yeah. And then Resident Evil 5 brought that in. So, you know, maybe that wouldn't really be a huge game mechanic, but it could maybe be a little bit more hectic. I don't know. I don't know what they would do.
You play 7?
I did, yeah. I actually played that last year, and I was really skeptical about it at first, but that game was amazing, dude.
Yes. I love that game.
So good.
Yeah.
How first person, that I didn't think that was going to work. I was like, dude, I don't really understand this, but, dude, it worked very well.
Yeah. That first about 2 or 3 hours where you're in the house,
mm-hmm.
and it's
like
so
a masterpiece.
Good. Yeah, it is so cool. Like
that fucking lady, what's her name, Margaret?
Margaret, yeah.
Yeah, dude, that bitch. Dude, she was creepy, man.
Yeah.
And I never played any of the DLC for that, though.
I think I played one. It wasn't, I mean, it's not that great. Resident
Evil. Yeah. I played Not a Hero. That's the one I played.
Yeah, that's the one.
Oh, is that the one where you play as Chris?
Yeah. And you kind of, like, go, like, backwards or something? Like,
yeah, you go back into the cave system, like, kind of clean it up.
Yeah, that was pretty cool.
Yeah, it was okay.
The caves were all right. I didn't really like the cave portion.
That was probably the weakest part, I think.
Yeah.
So Resident Evil 2 is like, because Mark was like, you can just buy it when we get paid next. So I think I'm just going to buy it. They have like the deluxe edition for like $23. So I should get it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's super worth it. It's good. It's good.
I'm going to do that. I'm going to do that then.
Yeah. It's real cool. Anything else you've been playing?
I started Spyro the Reignited Trilogy.
Nice.
Because I got that when it first came out, and I nerded out on it, and I 100%ed Year of the Dragon because that's my favorite one.
Yep.
So I played that one first, then I played Spyro the Dragon, 100% of that, and now I'm like 25% through Rip Dos Rage. So
you went 3-1-2,
yeah.
Yeah, she was super nostalgic for Spyro, like the first Spyro.
Yeah.
I've never played Spyro before. I think maybe a little bit back in the day, but no, I wasn't nostalgic for it. So I had gotten her the trilogy a couple of years ago whenever it first came out for Christmas. And we spent like the whole year of this year just going through all the games. We 100%ed every game. Like it was.
Oh, you did? You did all of it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, dude.
It was fun, dude. It was so much fun. That game is so cool. They really did an outstanding job with that.
I know. And apparently, from what I heard, Toys for Bob is actually trying to produce another, like their own Spyro.
That'd be cool. Well, really? I was telling Nick a couple weeks ago that they have a whole another trilogy on that came out on the PS2.
Oh, dude, the Enter the Dragonfly and all that shit.
Yeah,
dude,
yeah, yeah.
That game was like
ones too.
Yeah, there was well, they had that, you know, they had that whole system where like Elijah Wood played Spyro, the ones with like oh my god, what was it called? The one that you're thinking of, Nick, is called like something Ice and Fire or something like that.
Yeah,
I want to say. And then they had one come out for the PS2. It was called Enter the Dragonfly. I actually have that one. Okay. And that game fucking sucks, dude. And that game is like, it's not even done. Like, it's not even finished. And they had someone's come out on the Xbox 360, Dawn of something. But yeah, they had like Elijah Wood play Spyro, and then they ended up like changing everything. And that Cinder was like a new protagonist. It was like a girl.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, like when I played, the reason why I played the third one first is because Year of the Dragon is the first one I ever played.
Yeah, yeah.
And dude, that was like amazing because I remember like when I got it back in the day, there was like on the last hub world, there was a place you had to get 149 eggs to open. And as a kid, I never got it because I never was able to do things because, you know, I didn't understand like how games worked 100%.
Oh yeah, we looked up a lot of stuff and like playing.
Yeah,
yeah, it's not super
right there.
Straightforward.
Right.
So definitely, as a kid, you're just like, there's no way.
Yeah, you wouldn't like understand that crap. So when I played it this time, I was like, dude, I'm gonna do it, and I did it. And man, I went to a super bonus round, and I was dude, hell yeah, man, this is awesome. So that was really cool. But other than that. Yeah, just kind of wrap up. I've been talking a lot. That's pretty much what I've been playing. Just ready to start Spider-Man. I have tomorrow off, so I'm going to start probably Spider-Man tonight. See how that goes.
Nice.
It's pretty good. If you've ever played like the Batman games,
like the Arkham games.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
It's a lot like that, like as far as the fighting style goes, but just like the way, and I was telling Nick a couple weeks ago about it, but the way they blend, like
the scenes
flying through the city. Is so cool. Like you legit feel like Spider-Man.
Oh, dude, that's awesome. Sick.
Like, it is so cool. Sick.
It's by Insomniac Games, right? Which is
yeah.
Pretty crazy because that's who's like, they made like one of the original ones, right?
I don't know if they did the original. Like, I know like Spider-Man 2 back in the day was like a pretty.
That was a big one. Game.
But Insomniac made Spyro. They did the first
one. Yeah. I'm surprised that like they didn't have a take on, because I didn't know they still existed, but I'm surprised they didn't have a take on the Spyro Reignited trilogy.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know why they didn't. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, but who cares, man? Toys for Bob. I guess they nailed that thing.
Great job.
Probably owns that IP now. I don't think Insomniac does. But
yeah.
I wouldn't have anything to do with it. Yeah, that. Yeah, Spider-Man's real cool. It's definitely a lot of fun.
I'm super excited. I'm glad I got like the DLC and stuff. I've heard like the suits are really cool in that game too. So
there's so many too.
Yeah, that's what I heard. I heard there's like a shit ton because there's like what they introduced more whenever like each DLC came out.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, dude, I'm so ready.
Yeah, there's a ton of them.
Hell yeah.
So Nick, what you been playing?
So I got back into Tetris 99. me and
stacking battle royale.
Yeah, it's crazy, man. I still haven't won one, but. Harrison, when we did the podcast last week, Adam was talking about wanting to play it. So after we finished, we went back and played a few hours of Tetris 99, and he loved it. But God, I feel like I'm okay at Tetris, but when it comes to facing against 98 other people, I just freeze up and I have no idea what to do. And I can like get KOs and get people, but that just puts a target on your back, and it's just there's so many intricacies to it that I don't really understand yet.
Yeah, it's difficult to like, because at some point you're just, I mean, you can kind of just say it's a single player game because, I mean, you're just literally playing Tetris. And then whenever you start, you know, getting tiles and stuff, whatever, like you can start targeting other players. So if you see someone that's either getting ready to lose or something, you target them and like hit them with the blast or whatever. But yeah.
What is it on every console?
No, it's just Switch.
It's just Switch. Okay, yeah. Cool.
That's like their only really good thing about
their online. Remember the online membership.
Exclusive for online.
Which I can say I'm glad it's really cheap.
Yeah. It it's cheap because it sucks, but
yeah, it's whatever. But aside from that, Adam and I played through Human Fall Flat. Pretty much one go.
Yeah, I saw you had been playing that.
Yeah, it's a hilarious game when you're playing with someone else. Cause it's a physics based game, so you're just kind of messing around with the other person the entire time, trying to throw them off, and you're just completing these little puzzles, and like your little character is just so funny the way they move around. It's just kind of like
a rag doll,
a boneless
just, it's like that Octodad, like Deadliest.
Yeah. It's like Octodad. Yeah. You're kind of struggling to just like a normal person. Did you ever play that?
I think it's the same developer, but it's that I Am Bread game. Where you're like bread, and you have to like, you're like trying to get jellied or or something, and you have to like shoot up out of the toaster, and then you have to make your way to the counter, and there's like so many different things that you
like condiments and stuff. Dude, that's so funny. I've seen that. I've seen like the thumbnail of it, but I never played it.
It's pretty stupid, but it's pretty funny. Just the one, like it's one of those cool games to like play for an hour and then just forget about it.
Kind of like the goat simulator. Like goat simulator, like,
hey, that's gonna be free for January on PlayStation Plus.
Yes.
Oh, really?
Yeah. That and the Nathan Drake collection, which is actually pretty badass. Ooh,
that's pretty cool.
So I'm down with that. But yeah, speaking of that, like Newbie's Box Adventure. I don't know if you guys have seen that. That's on the Switch. It's like a physics-based game, but you're like a box and you're trying to get shipped to like somewhere. It's crazy. Like, it actually has pretty good graphics, but you guys should look it up. It's on sale right now for like $4.99. It's normally like $30.
Do you have a Switch?
Yeah. Okay. Oh yeah. I've been playing Pokemon Sword, so.
Oh yeah. Nice.
I was getting them shiny Magikarps for free.
How do you feel about that? Because I think me and Nick are kind of on the same page. Like, so Pokemon's awesome. I've always loved Pokemon.
Right.
I think I'm to the point where the next game they do, it's got to be dramatically different in some way. Like, whether it's like in an MMO style where you can see other people.
Yeah.
Abby, I know that, you know, like you can see the Pokemon in the real world now, which is super cool.
Mm-hmm.
But I just think I'm to that point where it's got to be something completely new that they never
knew. Yeah. I mean, like, I think one thing they need to get rid of is, like, they always try to do these gimmicks, and I feel like that's what really tries to, like, entice people. That's, like, the newness to the game.
Like
Dynamaxing and then Gigantamaxing. Like, it's too much, you know? And, like, I personally thought, like, Mega Evolutions were cool.
Those were super cool.
Right. Like, I think that's more viable. Now, I thought it was kind of dumb that they, like, disengage whenever you're like not in combat. But I think what they need to do is, like, if they were to bring back Mega Evolutions, make it to where, like, kind of like you were saying, Harrison, like if you make it to like an MMO, like make it to where like you have to do certain things to get that Pokemon. Don't just get like a fucking rock and then you have like a band and then it just evolves. Like make it to where like this Pokemon, like Sirfetch'd, you know, like Farfetch'd, you have to, there's like two ways to evolve it, but one of the ways is to get like three critical hits in one battle.
Yeah.
Or you have to just kill 10 Pokemon altogether and it can evolve. You know, like stuff like that. Like make it to where it's like a challenge to get this thing. But like the Gigantamaxing, I mean, like it's cool. It's cool that the Pokemon change physically, but it's not cool that it's like specific to certain ones.
Yeah. And then other than that, they just get really freaking big and it's like,
right. Yeah. And I mean, it's just like, I don't know. I mean, they're still like super susceptible to like super effective moves. Yeah. Like, doesn't really matter. I mean, like the max raids are really cool. I actually, like the people that I work with at Jimmy John's, we actually last night, either Saturday or Sunday, they come over to like to my house and we have what's called Pokemon night. So we have Pokemon night or like Smash Bros night.
Yeah.
So we'll all just get our Switches together and we'll max raid, and that's what we did yesterday. But I don't know, like I'm like with you, like I bought it and I was so excited for it to come out, and then like now I kind of don't even really care about it. Yeah. You know, I was really excited to like complete the decks, and yeah, then like I wanted a shiny hunt, but then I kind of just lost interest.
Yeah, I think I just beat the fifth gym a couple of days ago. But yeah, I just kind of playing at like a different pace than I normally do with Pokemon.
Yeah.
Like I just
play. You're just not like all in?
Like two or three, yeah, all in. But here I've just been kind of, you know, 20, 30 minutes before like I get in bed and I'll, you know, bring my Switch with me, you know,
yeah,
out of gym or, mm-hmm, you know, get through, you know, through the next level or whatever.
Did you get Sword or Shield?
Sword.
And see, that's the thing too, is like, you know, they said there's like I know they had two gyms were different from each one.
Yeah.
But they said there was like specific Pokemon besides like Zacian and Zazamenda or whatever their name is. Mm-hmm. But like there have been Pokemon that are supposed to be in Shield that I've found in Sword.
Really?
Yeah. Like for example, what was it? Larvitar, right? What's the small one? What's the small version of Larvitar? Tyranitar.
Yeah, Tyranitar is the third one.
Yeah, what's the, whatever the small one? Like, I got him.
It's Larvitar, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so like, I got him. And then, like, one of the guys in my game, like, I thought Poltegeist was supposed to be, not Poltegeist, Sinistee or whatever. It was, like, a like specific, or at least I thought so. Maybe I could be wrong, but
yeah, I don't know. I don't super pay attention to the exclusives.
I think they just try to follow like the old style, and it's just like one of those games where like I said before, like nostalgia is a powerful thing, but like if you don't have a new idea that's good enough to like latch on, it's gonna fade very quickly. And I mean, Pokemon is like the epitome of that. It's like literally the same thing all the time, but they're just trying to spice it up here and there.
I wonder if they would ever not do two versions.
Probably not. It makes them too much money.
I think so too. And then they do the dual ones or whatever, and they sell. Yeah. You know, like,
I just wish they would do more. Like, make it.
They need to make a battle pass.
That's what they need.
Like, make a cheap ass battle pass, and then just like, you know, I don't know, man. They need to do something, or just have DLC, man. Like, have like, you know, they found all these like legendaries that are in the data itself, yeah, but like they're not there. And like, don't save them for special events. Like, fucking put them in the game, man. Like, release an update and be like, oh, by the way, we're gonna unlock this island that wasn't part of like the Galar region. And I don't know. And then like the region variants are cool, but also like lazy, because you're just going back on old Pokemon and you're
also, it's been done already.
Right. Yeah. Like you have Alolan forms. And so it's like, which were cool, man. Like, I mean, not gonna lie, like there are some where I'm like, damn, Galarian Rapidash, like a unicorn, dude, that thing's crazy looking. And it's like psychic fairy.
I love Weezing's form too.
Dude. Yeah. He's like a top hat and shit.
Yeah.
Favorite one though is Alolan Marowak. That's like
Alolan. Yeah. Yeah.
Ghost Fire. Like that's badass.
Yeah. It's pretty cool.
That's so sick. But yeah, I mean, I don't know. I think it's just, and hopefully, I'm hoping that like this is just the direction they're going. And so like with you seeing the Pokemon in the overworld and all that stuff, that eventually they'll have like a game where maybe on the next Switch console, like, or not Switch console, the next like Nintendo console that's going to be more powerful. Mm-hmm. Maybe have like a game like that where like, you know, you get different gear that like increases like your catch rate and all this shit, or you can modify. I know there was one, I think it was Black and White or something. You can modify Pokeballs. Like you can make your own Pokeballs or some shit like that.
Really?
There was something like that. Like there was, cause Black and White was like the only one I didn't play. And one of my friends was telling me about it. You can like put stickers on it and shit. Like it's not like the craziest thing, but
yeah,
you know, it adds some like independency to everyone else.
Yeah. That's pretty cool. There's a rumor that there might be like a Switch Pro coming out next year.
I saw that like 2 days ago.
You know, the new Xbox and PS5. So,
yeah. Dude, I'm ready for Breath of the Wild too.
Oh yeah, dude.
Yeah. That could be. I could see that coming out this year.
You think so? Like holiday?
It's been 3 years since.
Yeah, I think it'll come out since. Yeah, like November or something.
Yeah. When did they had that posting for Monolith Studios? I think a couple months ago, where they were trying to hire somebody for it, but I don't remember how long ago that was.
Yeah, I think
that might have been early last year.
Yeah, I think it was early last year. I'm ready for Metroid, dude. Damn
yeah,
it.
If that ever comes. Yeah,
I think this year, this, I feel like I say it every year, but like,
this is the year.
Yeah, like I just feel like their E3 is gonna be pretty crazy. I feel like they have to. I mean, with the new Xbox and PS5.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I mean, there's too much unannounced.
So I think they're gonna come out with some really awesome stuff.
I hope they announce God of War, like the next God of War.
Oh yeah.
God of War. That was God.
Dude, that ending was so sick, dude.
It set it up.
It did. That was like
so well.
I was really. Can we say spoilers on this channel?
Yeah.
We can say things. Okay, cool. But dude, when you got the Blades of Chaos, like I did not really think that was gonna work. But dude, what the hell? That was crazy.
They were like, I can't remember exactly what. I think they were in the boat or something, but. You needed something that burned or something.
Yeah.
I was like,
and he goes back.
I was like, no, they're not going to do it. And then you go back and you just get him. He's just, that game was so good.
It was. Just the cinematics. I remember like my wife, she always watched me play that game. And she was like, this is like my most favorite game I've ever watched you play. Because it's so like cinematic, man. It's so like seamless. And like, beautiful. I don't know what other game Santa Monica Studios makes, but dude, like.
Yeah. I mean,
I don't know, man.
PS5 got some. Or Sony in general, like what's the other? I'm having a brain fart on it. The open world like animal mech game, what's it called?
Horizon.
Horizon, yeah.
Oh yeah, Zero Dawn, whatever.
Yeah, yeah. They're like Horizon 2. Like Sony's just got the best, like first party exclusives.
They do. Uncharted,
Last of Us, Uncharted, God of War.
I will have to say, I don't know why. But like I have to like make myself play The Last of Us because I downloaded The Last of Us Remastered.
Yeah.
And like I got barely in and I didn't like it. And I don't know why. Yeah, I don't know why. Like it's not like it's a bad game because it's fucking Naughty Dog. Like I played every single Uncharted game.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The only one I haven't played is the one with the girls. I don't know.
Lost Legacy.
Yeah, yeah. And that one's
I always wanted to go back and play. I'm sure you could find it for cheap now.
Yeah, I think it's only like I think right now it's like $15 on PlayStation, but
like 30 or 40 to start out with. So.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, you should go back and play The Last of Us. It's
really good.
Another shot at least because that game, man, that ending, that whole experience with Ellie
and Joel and everything.
Yeah, oh, it's so good.
Such a good dynamic, like probably the best like character dynamic I've seen between.
Yeah. It's
gonna be super cool. I'm gonna say, is Spider-Man a pretty story-driven game?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it's definitely, it's a comic book game, so if you know the comics well, I guess
mm-hmm.
you probably get more out of it than someone that doesn't. But it's still pretty cool.
Okay,
I like it because it's not Spider-Man's origin. It's like 7 or 8 years after he became Spider-Man.
Okay, so he's just already established.
Yeah, so he's pretty established. He's not in school anymore. He's, you know, he's. Working and stuff, so it's pretty cool. It's like a different because you don't really. I mean, every sort of Spider-Man you see in any sort of media, it's always him as a kid, and he's and he's you know the nerdy kid or whatever, and he's trying to find his way. But
what am I doing with my life?
Yeah.
Shut up.
Nick, anything else you've been playing?
Yes.
There's a load.
I'm really excited to talk about this one. So I started Death Stranding.
Oh, holy shit, dude.
Yeah.
Holy shit. I have watched walkthroughs of that game, and I do not understand any of it.
So just to give a brief synopsis
about the walking simulator,
I understand so far is, I think it was 3 years ago, there was this like cataclysmic event where everyone thought it was nukes, like a war,
mm-hmm.
but... It wasn't like the missiles, air quotes, didn't leave any craters or anything. And then these BTs started showing up, and BTs stand for beach things, which
beach?
Doesn't make too much sense.
Beach things like BACH?
Yeah, BACH. And the beach plays a big part because it's kind of like synonymous with the multiverse, and like everyone kind of has their own beach that they go to, like when they're dreaming or I don't know.
What?
Sounds like a Kojima game. Continue.
Yeah. So we have the BTs, and then we have the BBs, which are bridge babies, which are little babies in
these the little sock things.
Attach yourself, and they help you kind of detect the BTs. And
okay.
Yeah. So Sam, the main character, is a porter, which means he's a glorified delivery man. And he's delivering the supplies to all these different like composts.
He's trying to connect.
He's trying to reconnect America. Like that's kind of what the plot, like where the plot goes at the beginning of the game.
Okay.
Because everyone, I think from my understanding, everyone lives underground. So you'll go to this post, you'll drop off these packages, and then the shelf will like go down underground. So everyone's like living underground because the surface is pretty toxic with timefall, which is rain. So whenever rain is falling from the sky, it accelerates the aging process. So if it touches your skin, it'll, make your skin 90 years old.
What?
But once it hits the ground, it's just water. So if you put on a hood or if you're covered head to toe, then you're fine out in the rain. But rain is where the BTs are. So wherever it's raining, you're more likely to run into a BT.
Okay.
So... The first two or three chapters of the game. I'm on chapter four now. So last week we were talking about it, and we were talking with Noodle. Is that his name?
Yeah.
On Twitch, and he said just to go as fast as you can until chapter four, because that's when it really opens up.
Yeah,
that's kind of what I did. I didn't really take any of the side quests because they're just delivery missions, going from one like carrying all this cargo from one place to another. But I went as quickly as I could to get to chapter four, and that was like 12 hours. But in chapter three, the game really opens up. Like you start to get vehicles, and you get like this suit that can make you run faster. And it kind of gives way to some like really, really cool moments. Like one time I was running away from some mules, which are like a terrorist organization that is trying to steal, all of your packages pretty much, and trying to deliver them themselves and get money. I don't know, man.
It's FedEx trying to steal the Amazon Prime vans.
Yeah, pretty much. But I was running away from them, and I would have my suit on where I could run really fast, but it was battery powered. And I was running out to this like big, like 15-foot gap. I was like, I have to jump across this. Like, I don't know what to do. And I jumped, and I was probably like a foot short, and I just slammed to the side and fall down this, 20-foot drop.
All your packages came out?
Yeah, so all my packages fall on the freaking ground, and I had to pick them all up. And now I'm stuck down there, and I have to use a ladder to climb up. And then while I was doing that, one of the guys shot me, and I fell off the ladder and fall all the way down again. And it's like part of the game is really annoying because you're constantly trying to stabilize yourself. Like, and the more packages you have, the less stable you are. So you kind of have to hold the triggers while you're walking.
Do you feel it like in the joysticks?
Yeah. You feel it in the rumble.
Okay.
You're walking over rocks. You can feel like the lack of stability. And then you can use a scanner that'll kind of show you visually the stability levels of each.
The terrain.
Of the terrain, yeah, of where you're walking. So you can.
The weight distribution plays like a huge, you have to be pretty strategic of how you place your packages on your back.
Yeah, but you can also auto place your packages, which that's why I just go into the start menu and auto organize everything, because I don't feel like
right.
Otherwise, you'd have to take everything off and put it back in a certain order.
Yeah,
which doesn't make sense.
So let me stop you real quick.
Yeah,
you're having fun with it.
I actually am. It's super cathartic just to walk from place to place and kind of it's like a little puzzle. Like, how am I going to get over this? How am I going to get around this? How am I going to get my freaking car through this water?
It's kind of like From games where you kind of see other people around in the game.
You don't see them around.
I actually see them, right? You see like the roads they've built and stuff like that, right?
Yeah. So once you reconnect a region, which is just going to that region and using something to reconnect it, you can see everything else that the players have done. Well, you can see a lot of what the players have done. So players can like build roads or build bridges that make traversing the terrain a lot easier. So a lot of the times you're traveling to reconnect this area, and then on your way back, it's a lot easier because you have all these bridges built and have all these roads already constructed.
Yeah, I mean, that's so theoretically, I mean, if I were to pick this game up a year from now, my experience with it could be completely different than you, because there's more roads and stuff. So in a way, is it less? I mean, because if everyone builds roads and kind of makes it easier, does it kind of lose that difficultiness, or, you know, the hardship that you've had to go through of getting to another town or settlement or whatever?
Not necessarily, because the first time you're going somewhere normally,
yeah,
you can't access anything else that that other players have done, because you have to like take that place online, and that'll reconnect everything. Then you can see. Gotcha.
Okay, that makes sense.
All of these items that are put in place by other people.
Okay.
So it, even if you're playing a year from now, you're still gonna have a similar experience.
Right. But it's just once you turn that area on, right, then you'll see everything.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's cool. I want to play it.
It looks interesting.
I don't know. Like, I don't know why I've liked it so much. Yeah. I think it's just so different than anything that I've played before.
Well, it's Hideo said he wanted to create a new genre called the Strand.
It's a Strand game. You know, it's a Strand game. I didn't fight a single person until chapter 3.
Yeah.
And when I got to chapter 3, I was just using non-lethal weapons. Yeah. Like, I had this gun that just kind of ties them up.
Yeah.
And then you can obviously punch people and hit them with your cargo. But it wasn't until chapter 4 that I actually got lethal weapons. And I just got to chapter 4 today, so I haven't played much of it. But it's like right when I got to chapter 4, it was like the genre changed completely. And okay, I was in like a normal action game.
Yeah.
So I'm excited for where it goes. I've heard, you know, chapters 2 and 3 are a slog, which is why I kind of beeline towards them. But I think the fact that I did that made me enjoy the game a lot more, because
I'm not
tired of it by now.
Yeah, because you would have, you know, spent all that time delivering that stuff, and then you're like, oh, well, I get all these cool upgrades in chapter 3 or 4 or whatever that could have, and now you can go back and kind of do that stuff. You know, it is unfortunate when games are like that, because people who don't listen to podcasts or kind of keep up with the news or anything, like, you don't know to skip ahead.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't really, because I think that's a big issue of, like, I think it was Final Fantasy 13, where everyone was like, oh, after you play for 20 hours, then it gets really good. It's like, no, I don't want to spend 20 hours in the game for it to get good.
Yeah, that was like a Xenoblade Chronicles
as
well. But I mean, I ended up loving that game.
Yeah.
But a lot of games do take a pretty long time to get really good. I feel like with Death Stranding's case, people were doing the completionist type of play style, and that doesn't bode well for a game with so much so much monotony.
Yeah.
Because you're walking or taking your bike or, you know, running from place to place and avoiding these BTs, which are very, very stressful when you come upon some rain, and then the game will like kind of chug for a second to indicate that BTs are around, and then you'll have to crouch, and there's like a button where you can cover your mouth, and then your baby will start crying, and you have to physically soothe your baby by rocking your PS4 controller.
So,
I mean, you don't have to, but
it seems interesting and it looks cool, and I know the lore and stuff is probably ridiculous and crazy just because it's Hideo Kojima. Yeah,
I'm still trying to wrap my
head around it. And it's probably hard to understand, but look at me. I do want to play it at some point.
Yeah. And I've liked all the characters. Troy Baker's, you know Troy Baker?
Yeah, the guy that's in everything.
Yep. His character, he's plays
him
like
Nolan North.
Yeah, him and Nolan North. But Troy Baker plays like the villain in the game. And it's a pretty sweet villain. There's a point where he takes off a mask and there's another mask underneath. I was like, wow, that's stupid, but I'm all for it.
Right. Yeah. Stupid masks.
Yeah.
Anything else you've been playing?
Not really. I haven't picked up Pokemon since probably Thanksgiving.
I don't know. I forgot about it. Did you beat all the gyms?
No.
No. So I have been playing Ring Fit Adventure.
Hey.
And I don't know, like, so I come home and do my little workout thing, whatever, and then I'm done. I didn't realize how, dude, I've been sweating.
I told you.
It's like, I mean, you start off, you do your little jog thing, you're like, okay, and then, like, you fight that first monster or whatever, and, you know, you have your, I think, three or four, like, workouts or whatever. I think it might be three. Mm-hmm. No, I think it's four. And then you start to just... I started at the second top difficulty. So, I mean, you go down and do those squats, and you're holding it for, like, a good while, and then you have to bounce back up, and then it's like...
And those are doing, like, 30-something of 30-something
squats?
Yeah,
30 of them.
For one attack?
Yeah, for one attack. And, you attack every time you come back up.
Yeah,
but there's, like, one, a little bit of damage. But they got pretty meaty health, and there's pretty much 30 reps you have to do. So the first half is back with, like, the longer reps where you have to hold it, and then you go back up. And then the second half is, you know, you go real quick. And it's like that for, I think, most of the ones I've seen. I've only unlocked in one additional workout or whatever. Mm-hmm. But it's pretty cool. I think I'm on level two, maybe. Or not level two, like world two.
World two.
Man, like, I was not expecting to sweat like that.
Yeah, it kicks your butt.
Yeah. After the first time I did it, I was just, and my shirt was, like, pretty wet. I was like, oh my gosh, like, I was just not expecting this. It's crazy because Nintendo has always tried to do some sort of gimmicky exercise thing.
Yep.
And I think with this, they nailed it. I think
it actually works. Yeah.
Like the band you have, like the resistance band, actually, like when you're holding it up like this and, like, squeezing on the top, like it
that kills, man.
It worked, but it works. Like, I feel it. Like, that first day after I woke up the next day, like, I was pretty sore. I'm not usually used to that when it comes to working out and stuff. Mm-hmm. But I was doing different stuff than I normally do. And, like, because usually I'll do, like, jump squats when I, like, I'll hold, like, a 10-pound weight or something, and I'll just do jump squats. But, yeah, going down and holding it, and then, I don't know, it's just,
It's crazy how much they nailed it.
Yeah, it's like they take the boringness of, you know, working out. I mean, it can get pretty mundane. Yeah, they take the boringness of working out and make it something really, really cool. And it's super easy to do.
It just makes it fun. Like, and unlocking new exercises is really exciting.
Yeah.
And your normal day, you're like, oh, I have to do this other exercise. And now it's.
And then, like, I like the fact that after you do an exercise, whatever, when you're in battle, like, there's, like, a little timer, so you can't immediately do the same thing. You have to do something different at least.
Yeah, it forces you to switch it up, which is cool.
Yeah, so it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
So I'm talking about Ring Fit Adventure, that new exercise game that came out for the Switch.
Oh, the little bling, bling, bling thing? Yeah. Have you guys played that?
Yeah, Nick got it, and he had talked about it about a month ago, whatever. And he's getting it for me for Christmas.
Yeah, okay.
I was just saying that it kicks your butt, man. Like, I was not expecting it. Like, the first time I used it, I was sweating. Like, the next day I was sore and stuff. And, I was telling him that, you know, I come home and, you know, do some exercises.
Yeah.
So I kind of put it on the second to top difficulty, whatever.
Okay.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. Like, it's...
Yeah. There are 30 difficulty levels. And when you're,
oh my God,
when you're close to the top, you're doing, for, like, one set of attacks on an enemy, you're doing 30 plus reps of whatever it is. So, like, if you're using squats to attack, you're doing 30 plus squats, and you're holding these squats for probably 3 seconds a piece. And that's just for, like,
one enemy.
Yeah,
enemy,
like, one attack. And the enemies have, like, a pretty decent amount of health. Like, it takes a while.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of, like, similar to oh my gosh, what is it, like, in Smash Brothers, when you do, like, the World of Light, like, you know, you have, like, the different, like, the trio of things. It's kind of like that, right?
Like, yeah, in terms of choosing your attacks.
Yeah, like, there's, like, some that are stronger against, like, other things, and vice versa.
Well, these I don't think there's any stronger, like, more strong or weak.
There will be. That is an ability that unlocks.
Okay. Does the thing like gain resistance? Like, is how does it? Yeah, so, is it just a piece of plastic?
I've got it right here.
Okay.
you snap the
Joy-Cons.
Joy-Con into here.
Okay.
It's pretty like, I mean, it's.
It's pretty resistive.
Yeah, it's pretty resistant, and you can like stretch it for some of the stuff. So it's, I mean, it's pretty awesome. Like I was just telling him, like when you, there's one exercise where you put it over your head and then you have to like squeeze it.
Oh Lord.
It hurts. Like,
yeah, because I mean, no one does that.
Yeah. It's pretty, pretty resistant. Like I wouldn't think like, because normally when I work out, I use some sort of, you know, weights or something.
Right.
I felt like almost I got a better workout with that just because. Mm-hmm. I had like a nice resistance to it.
Does it have like a campaign, like, or is it just like little? Like,
the games? Story is like you're walking through this forest, and like there's like an animated ring that I just showed you, and you go pick it up, and I think you squeeze yours, and it breaks it, and then this giant muscular like dragon guy comes out,
like a bodybuilding dragon,
like Drago or something. Drago.
Yeah, Drago.
He's like this big bodybuilder dragon bro. And he's got
a tank top on.
It kind of turns into like Mario with like the overworld kind of thing, where it's
okay. Oh, like we're like the like worlds.
Yeah.
Okay.
You kind of do that, and then you have the other Joy-Con, the blue one, a strap that you put on your leg, and then you kind of jog in place, and that's how you move the world. And then if you squeeze the band,
it shoots things.
Yeah, you emit like this puff of like smoke or something. And that's how you destroy boxes, and you can collect coins and stuff.
And you can suck coins in.
And then you can suck in, like coins away. And then it's pretty cool that they were pretty smart about it as far as, like, if you live in an apartment or something, they have, like, a quiet mode, which instead of running, you do squats or something like that. I haven't tried that part out.
Oh, Lord. Could you imagine?
It's like mini squats. That's what I do since I'm on the 11th floor, so I don't want to jog in place and, you know, upset my downstairs neighbors.
Screw them. Now that's nice. That's a cool feature. Yeah, that's like a very small thing that
think a lot about.
Yeah, about it. Nintendo though, that's the thing, that's the crazy thing about them is like, you know, they're never like ahead when it comes to like graphics and like power of a system, but like they're like ingenuity when it comes to like the accessories that come with the product.
It was out of nowhere too. Like they drop a trailer and then it's like, hey, it's coming out.
I remember they made like a memes about the two people that were there that they're like they were like serial killers.
But it's pretty cool. Like the Nintendo Labo thing. I mean, I never got into
That. That didn't last that long, but yeah, that was interesting.
Yeah, I mean, after like Guitar Hero and stuff, like I don't really want too much like peripherals in my home anymore. It's just they're always doing cool things, which
I feel like the Ring Fit thing is cooler because like with the Labo everything was like cardboard, so I mean I don't know how durable it was, but at least with that I mean I could see like every time that thing maybe like, well, I don't even know, what is it made of? Is it plastic like, or is it rubbery?
It's rubbery to the touch, but I think it's some sort of like
just flexible plastic.
Like
I mean it's like a Pilates ring. Whatever that material is made out, whatever.
Oh wow!
It looks like it's pretty high.
But quality. It feels durable.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Like you can squeeze it in. And, like you. Yeah. It's. I feel like it's gonna last a pretty good long.
And time. It comes with a game, and it's only like $80.
I think it's is it 70 or is it 80?
80 bucks. Yeah.
80. That's not bad. I mean, because usually like they usually come out with like the game and then like, you know, accessory sold separately, and then you have to buy that, and it's like another $80. But that's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. But so I've been playing, well, Nick, do you have anything else you want to talk about as far as what you've been playing?
No.
Did you finish with Death Stranding? Is that the last thing you talked about?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
So I kind of incorporate this into like the news, the one news thing I found. So The Witcher is like the most watched like show on Netflix of all time. Like it's gone up above.
Is it really?
Yeah, it's gone up above
Mandalorian?
Stranger Things.
Oh crap.
So it's pretty damn popular, and man, dude, that show, I watched it a second time now that I knew the timeline.
Really?
Yeah. Dude, I love that world. Like even Brittany, she was just like, "You're seriously watching the show again?" I was like, "Yeah, it's awesome." But like,
I started it.
A lot of things because, you know, it was Christmas time and I was wrapping presents and whatever, so, and you know, talking. It's one of those shows where you gotta pay attention, otherwise, a lot of stuff. So yeah, Nick, I know you've watched it. Trey, have you seen it?
Yeah, me and this man just got done. We finished it like 2 days ago. I think it only took us like 2 or 3 days to watch it. But I'm not like, I played a little bit of The Witcher 3, so I'm not too familiar with everything. But like, we both watched it. We were like, dude, is there going to be a season two? And then we found out there is. So we were just like super excited.
Yeah.
So I played a little bit of The Witcher 2 back when it was on the 360. And then I got Witcher 3 when it first came out. Like, I think it was in 2015. And I got probably like 7 or 8 hours into it. And then I just stopped playing. I guess I wasn't into it. I don't know why.
Yeah.
But you know, with the show coming out, whatever. And I watched it, and apparently it's got like 100,000 concurrent players, like on Steam or something now.
I saw that.
It got me into the world again. So like, I started playing it, and now I think I'm almost open again, where I had left off. And there was so much stuff that I didn't do, like as far as leveling on my character. Trey, you remember back in the day whenever you were first playing Mass Effect?
Oh my god!
And you were, I think I was watching you play. And like, I pulled up your menu for leveling up and stuff, and you hadn't touched it at all.
Dude, so, I did not get that game at all, man.
You were like, God, this game is so hard or something. And then like, I pulled up your menu, and I was like,
dude, you have to level up. It's like not going to the constellations in Skyrim.
I didn't do a lot of that stuff, and I didn't do any sort of, I didn't mess with like any of the signs or anything and level those up. Or like get into like the alchemy and as far as like fighting monsters, I didn't look at, cause it's really cool. Like look at the monsters in the bestiary, you can see what they're weak against, and you can,
right.
You can put the oils on your sword to make it easier for you. Like I didn't do that at all.
Yeah.
But now that I'm like playing it, like it's, God, man, it's such a,
it's like, it makes it more like immersive.
It's so much fun. Like doing like I was doing the missions, and then I started doing like the Witcher contracts and just going off and fighting just random, like monsters and stuff, dude.
I was the same with you. I got to a certain part in the game, and I really don't remember what it was, but I think I got to a cave, and there was like these wraiths or something.
Yeah.
And I think there were like two at the beginning of the cave, and then when you go in there, you fight like a main wraith or something like that, and I couldn't beat it. And I had like no healing potions, and so I was like, well, I'm gonna leave the cave. Well, then when I went to go search out in the world, I couldn't like find anything. So I was like, dude, what the fuck? So that is what made me stop playing it. Because I just I couldn't do anything. I was like, dude, I'm stuck, I'll have to start over. And I think I was like 15, maybe 20 hours in. If that, it might have been like, I know that I at least killed that the thing that flies overhead that like terrorizes people. Oh, it's Griffin. Like, yeah, the Griffin thing. I don't know how. I think that's actually really early in the game, actually.
Yeah, that's pretty.
The first 2 hours. That's the first hour.
That's the first thing you do.
Yeah.
It literally is the opening scene. But yeah, I remember that because I remember like, doesn't the head, like he puts it on the horse and it's like, it's like on Roach.
It's got like the trophies, whatever. Like,
right.
You
know, yeah.
Each monster you kill on through a contract.
Yeah,
they each have like their own ability or something.
Yeah.
So like one is like extra 5% gold, or one's, you know, extra 5% of your signs or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, I'm just, I can't stop playing it, man. I'm so,
what are you playing it on?
I'm playing on Xbox.
Okay.
Because I got, like I said, I got it back in the day, and then they recently just added it to Game Pass.
Oh, okay.
So I went ahead and just re-downloaded it.
Right.
And then just started over. I'm kind of jealous of Nate because you got it on Switch.
Yeah, that's what, like, I was about to say that.
To play, you know, just laying in bed or chilling on the couch or something. But, man, I don't think I've ever watched a TV show or a movie or something, and it got me hyped up to play a game, or at least an older game. Like, it's, I don't know, it's bizarre, but I'm kind of glad I kind of, you know, stopped playing it today, because now I can appreciate
it more.
And like, you know, when I find, you know, when you see Yennefer and Chris and, you know, all the characters and stuff, and read the books about the fall of Syndra. Like, it's cool. Like, it's cool seeing that stuff. So.
Right. There are two downsides to the Switch version.
Yeah.
One is the graphics, obviously.
Yeah, of course.
Honestly, I feel like the graphics get better after you get out of White Orchard.
Okay.
First area. I feel like they're really bad at first, or I'm just getting used to them. I don't know. Like, they get a lot better. And then the second part is the game crashes for me at least every 3 or 4 hours.
Oh, wow. Oh,
damn.
Yeah. I don't know. I don't know why. I don't know what makes it crash.
Weird.
But,
well, at least, I mean, I hard save a lot in that game, so.
Yeah. It's never lost me any significant progress, so.
Well, that's good. So, like, it pretty, like, it constantly keeps itself up to date, like, as saving, like, auto-save and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, it auto-saves pretty good. There was a couple times where, especially, like, I don't know if y'all have done the mission before. It's like Ginny O' the Woods or something.
Mm-hmm.
And, I wouldn't remember it. It was, like, so long ago.
I ended up dying a couple times to her. And then I was like, what the hell, man? It's, like, only level 10. And then I looked, and, like, my sword was almost completely depleted. And I was like, well, there we go.
That makes sense, because, like, from what I remember, I didn't even think you could, like, upgrade shit. So, like...
Oh, yeah.
So it's probably like the same thing. Like, I'm probably treated like Mass Effect.
Yeah, like some swords, there's like nodes and stuff that you can add to it, but like your swords deplete pretty quickly. So you gotta make sure
you gotta keep up with them.
Yeah.
Hmm.
God, man, that game.
Have you gotten to Skellig yet?
No, I'm on the mission where to get on the boat, which is exactly where I stopped off before. But like, I'm trying to go back and do all the Witcher contracts that I can do. I know I have a couple that are, it's like level 25 or something crazy like that.
Yeah.
But yeah, man, that world is just so much fun to explore. Like
it really is.
Like, yeah, it's good. Yeah. I love it.
That's where I'm at right now. I think I'm really close to getting on the boat. That's been my mission for like 5 hours.
Cause it's an overarching
mission. And then you have all these quests in between.
Yeah. I just recently did the Baron mission, again. Which was really cool.
Oh yeah, the Bloody Baron.
Yeah, Bloody Baron mission.
That's cool. So,
but yeah, that game's pretty good. But other than those two games, that's really what I've been playing.
Mm-hmm.
Just diving into The Witcher, man. It's a cool game.
Good old Witcher.
Cool world.
Are you guys excited for like any games that are like up and coming that we know of?
Yeah. So, Last of Us Part Two, definitely.
What did they have a release date for that?
May.
Oh, wow.
It was like February 23rd or 28th, something like that, but then they pushed it back to May. Okay. So that coming out in May. I'm actually really looking forward to the Dragon Ball Z game coming out.
Oh, Kakarot?
Yeah.
Oh, Kakarot.
Yeah.
That looks pretty cool.
That does look really good.
And then obviously Halo Infinite. I'm super into Halo, so I'm looking forward to that when that comes out at the end of the year, or should at least. They haven't done like an official.
Have they, like, said anything about it, like, what it's going to be? Because I know there's been, like, speculation that, like, you know, oh, it's going to be Battle Royale, oh, it's going to be this.
Other than, like, the first trailer they dropped last year, E3, where, like, Master Chief was in space with some guy, I can't remember his name, and he, like, turned it back on or whatever. Other than that, they haven't done any sort of multiplayer details or anything. So.
Is it still 343?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
So, I mean, Halo 5 was, the multiplayer was awesome, but the story was kind of lame.
Mm-hmm.
That was kind of like the biggest drawback of that game. So hopefully
they probably learned a lot from that.
Yeah, I'm sure they did. So hopefully I'm looking forward to that game. I'm sure it's going to be a launch game for the Series X or whatever. But
I think it's going to be a launch game.
Yeah, I think it will be. I know there's some other games too that are Cyberpunk.
Dude, obviously. I'm ready for the next From Software game, Elden Ring.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Dude.
That shit's gonna be awesome. I've been like, I keep going back and forth about buying Dark Souls Remastered for the Switch.
Yeah.
Because like, I know how like you were saying, like, you know, you're jealous of Nick playing The Witcher on the Switch.
Yeah.
That's like, some games, man, just feel different. Like, I don't know what it is. Like, I remember I bought Darksiders on the Switch not too long ago,
mm-hmm.
and did like 100% of it. And like, it was like, I was so drawn to it. But like, when I play it on my PS4, I'm like, you know, like, I don't really care about it. And then same thing, like, with Diablo. Like, when I had Diablo 3 on the PS4, I played it a lot. But then when I got it on the Switch, like, it just, it changes it.
It's just playing while pooping, man.
Yeah.
Diablo for Black Friday. And I'm always trying to get, like, some co-op names that, you know, me and Brady can play through.
Yeah.
We had played it a couple of years ago, but we never finished it. So we'll probably go through that.
What was this, Diablo?
Yeah, the
whatever. Eternal Collection or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's good, man. I haven't played it a long time, and I played it last night when we had Pokemon night. Yeah. I was like, hey, does anybody have like Diablo 3 if they want to play? And one of the guys, Jason, he was like, dude, I do. And we played, and I basically, he's had it for like a year. And I was like, dude, what level are you? And he was like, 3. I was like, dude, what the hell? I was like, I have like every character level 70 with like whatever Paragon. I was like, yeah, I'll just run you through some dungeons. And I kind of like forgot like how to play, which was kind of hard. But that game was fun. I'm ready for Diablo 4. Have you seen the trailer for Diablo 4?
Yeah, the trailer's pretty sick.
Dude,
yeah,
that was crazy.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to think of other stuff. I know there's tons of stuff.
Looking forward to Doom too.
Doom.
Oh, Eternal or whatever.
Yeah. Oh yeah, Doom Eternal.
I never played it on the PS4, but I bought it on the Switch, and I hated it because I guess just like the graphics and like the motion blur.
Yeah.
You can turn that off.
You can't. Well, damn it! I wish I would have known that. I literally had like my wife, like at her work, got like an Amazon gift card, and for whatever reason, she doesn't use Amazon, so like she just gave them all to me. So I was like, oh, dude, I'm gonna buy Doom, and I bought it, and I was like, dude, it gives me a headache. Like I literally could play for like an hour, and I was like, dude, I can't do it.
Look up some settings for Doom Switch. I know that's one of them that you can
turn off. It just made me sick because that's how like Vice City was when I played Grand Theft Auto Vice City. It had that like motion blur crap, and it makes you want to throw up. I'm just like, oh my god.
Yeah, it's kind of weird that they went with that for the default.
Yeah, I mean, because it's such a fast-paced game, you think you wouldn't want that. And I don't know if maybe they try to use that to kind of cut down on like you noticing like how downgraded the graphics are. But
is that just a Switch thing, or is that because I don't remember them having that on?
Yeah, see, I don't know because I never played it on a console besides.
They asked you in the beginning.
Well, I think it's a problem with. It probably is on console, but console 60 FPS and Switch.
Right. Yeah.
So motion blur probably looks a lot worse, or has a more negative effect on 30 FPS than 60.
Yeah. It was. God, it was horrible. Like it was a fun game. Like it was cool, but I was just like, I feel like Doom is just one of those games that you want to play on like a super modded like PC where everything is just like super crisp and awesome. Kind of reminds me of one of those games are always Crysis. I feel like those games were always like ahead of their time and just were insane.
That was kind of like what you knew you had like the best of the best PC if you could run.
When you can run Crysis. That was a crazy. That's like, there's a game that uses the Crower engine. The Showdown, The Showdown?
Oh, yeah.
I never played it, but it recently started popping up in my YouTube feed and, they're like adding stuff to it, and that game looks like insane. I don't know what it is, but
it's like some sort of like multiplayer game, but they have monsters and stuff embedded throughout the world, and you have to they're like super hard to kill, and you have to team up and get like their items they drop or something. But I've seen a couple of streams of it, but I haven't actually played it myself. But
gotcha.
Yeah, I'm kind of excited for. So I feel like either maybe at E3 or near that time, I think Nintendo has to drop some sort of inclination of improving their online service.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, because I mean, Xbox with their Game Pass and how awesome that is, and PlayStation is starting to catch up with their stuff they're doing. Mm-hmm. As far as their, I know they do like, what is it? Not the gold, but PS Plus, whatever. PS Now and stuff. So I just feel like Nintendo's got to do something and overhaul their system. Yeah, it's cheap. It's $20 a year, $25 a year, or $5 a month, but it's just not good.
I mean, they should tier it. They should what they should do is they should find a way to like make it to where like if you want the $20 a year, then you just have like your SNES games and then whatever else. And then like if you pay $30 a year, you can get like Nintendo 64 games. And if you pay $40 a year, they pour over like GameCube games or something. If it can run, I'd imagine it would be able to.
Or just start adding 64 games and start adding GameCube games and stuff, and then like a free game every month or something.
Nintendo's always been, like I said, they've always been like behind on stuff like that. Like they excel in other areas, but when it comes to that stuff, like which is weird because they're all about like localized fun.
Yeah.
Not really like expanded fun.
I think it'd be like a separate phone app to actually chat with somebody on the
screen. Yeah, like that's so dumb. Like, oh, hold on, man. Let me.
I did that one time with Eric, and I was like, this is so stupid. I'm just gonna call you.
I used it for Splatoon.
Yeah.
And that was.
You mean I'm just gonna call you here? Let me just voice chat.
It's stupid. And then like the whole the friend code thing is ridiculous. Like I think they just need to overhaul that whole their whole online perspective. I mean they're smart people. They just
right. They just don't execute that
behind on.
Well, I think it's too is because a lot of the games that they create aren't like. I mean, Splatoon obviously is a very like heavily multiplayer game. That's pretty much like all it is. But there's not that many. I mean, any Nintendo game that you get is always like pretty much solo story driven.
Which is what I prefer. I mean, to be
honest. Right. Yeah. It makes for like a complete game. You know, like when they have to worry about multiplayers, they have to worry about like updates and all this shit, people complaining. So when you have like a game that's already finished, that's awesome. Like, dude, like I'm telling you, man, like Breath of the Wild, like. That game was insane, dude. Like, I never thought, like, because that's honestly, like, the first Zelda game I've ever played, like, ever.
Yeah.
The first one that I played and remember was Minish Cap. But I remember growing up and watching my brother play Majora's Mask, which, for whatever reason, like, I love that game, but I never played it. I just love, like, when people talk about it, I know about it just because of my brother. But, like, dude, Breath of the Wild, I mean, that game's up there with me, it was Skyrim. That game just so.
I wonder. I don't know if I would want this necessarily, but like Breath of the Wild 2, like maybe have like some sort of co-op or something. That would be pretty.
Yeah, cool. I don't know. Like you don't have to rescue Princess Zelda, and she's actually your like.
Yeah.
She is player two. Badass. That would be cool. That would be pretty cool.
I mean, I don't know how they would do it. I don't know if I would even want that per se, but it'd be. I don't know. It'd be interesting, but yeah, Breath of the Wild 2. Like, I don't know. I wonder if it's going to be like a full sequel, because I imagine they're going to use. I mean, because usually, like Zelda games are 5 or 6 years apart.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, I don't know if it'll come out this year, but
they'll probably use the same engine.
Might. So I wonder if they're going to use like the same map and obviously better graphics and all that stuff. But I don't know.
I don't know, man, because, I mean, you never really, like, I mean, what, they showed Ganon or whatever.
Yeah, they showed that he was, like, whatever. Still alive or something.
Like he's, like, a zombie or some shit, like, whatever the hell he was. But, I mean, God, dude, that game was just, but the one thing that, like, I didn't really understand, which kind of threw me off, was, like, I always thought there was going to be a third DLC. I don't know why. Like, I always just thought that. Like, I felt the game, like, was complete, but then like they added like, you know, DLC 1, DLC 2, but like I don't know why, but I just felt like it was like they were working on it and then
maybe the
like
roadmap
they just stopped.
They laid out was like misleading.
I think they might have started working on the third DLC and then I think it became Breath of the Wild 2.
Oh, like was it like maybe it was like already like so big that they were just like, dude, screw it.
I feel like I read that somewhere that it was just getting larger than what they initially thought, and they were like, hey, let's just do a second one of these, because
I don't know, that game was like just so like
it was a hard game.
It was really. I remember like first one of the craziest things that like I remember doing, and this I didn't know this was like an actual thing, but I was in the Thunder Plateau, and like the fact that like if you have any metal like weapon equipped, it like, you know, conducts electricity, and then also like if you're in like the hot area, like if it's, you have like a wooden shield, it'll burn. But like I remember there was this rusted sword that was like in the ground and it kept conducting the electricity, and I was like, huh, I want to try something out. And I remember I had choo-choo jelly in my inventory, and I threw it down and the lightning struck it and it turned into yellow choo-choo jelly.
Oh wow.
And like it, like, I just, you know, like, to me, that, like, that blew my mind. I was like, dude, holy shit. Like, that's just such a small detail that,
like they thought of everything.
Right, exactly. And then, like, when you pull out, like, an ancient weapon, and it has, like, that little beam, it has those little particles that come off.
Mm-hmm.
Like, whatever way the wind is blowing, the particles will blow that way.
Oh, I never noticed.
Like, yeah, I mean, it's just little shit like that. And then, like, the fact that, like, you can climb walls, but you have to have high stamina to get to, like, higher walls.
Yeah.
Like, and then you slip when it's raining. Like, yeah. Dude, just little things like that, just that's what makes the immersion, like, insane, dude. And I remember when I was playing that game, I was like, dude, what the hell? This is awesome. And then, like, what? Like, you get, like, a fire arrow, and you throw it into the grass, and it creates an updraft from, like, the flames, and then you can, like, glide over it and shoot you up in the air. Like, they thought of everything.
What, which one of the four heroes that gives you the ability to, like, kind of shoot up into the air?
That's Rivali's Gale.
Yeah.
So it's like, it's kind of like we were talking about earlier, Nick, about Death Stranding. It's like, if you knew these things going into the game, like, obviously, yeah, that would have been the one I would have shot to first, because then that's such a crucial ability, and you can, you know, kind of skip the whole climbing and stuff. But the fact that you go through that hardship and then you get to Rivali and you get that ability, you're like, oh my god,
it's so rewarding when you get it.
So rewarding.
Which divine beast did you go for first?
I went for the
water one.
Is that the camel?
No, which
one? Wait, the water one's the elephant.
Yeah, that's what I went to first.
Okay, yeah, I went to the camel.
Yeah.
So that was the
desert one? Like,
oh, that was the Rivali's Gale one.
Obviously,
is that what that was?
Oh, wait,
that was the Thunder one.
Yeah, the one that was up in the air.
Yeah, that was cool.
Yeah, what was that? Gerudo Valley? What the hell is that place called that you had to go to where you had to dress like a woman?
That was Gerudo Valley.
That was Gerudo Valley.
Yeah, that's where it was.
What ability did you get from that?
Some lightning thing.
Yeah, I think
it was the
lightning move, right?
Yeah. I forgot what it was called, but dude,
I can play that game because I never did beat the DLC.
I didn't either. Like, I never did, like, the Trial of the Sword or any of that shit.
I did the Trial of the Sword. I think I beat it, but then there's, like, a harder version where you have to, like, go through 50 levels. Like, I was like, nah, I'm not doing that.
Yeah,
and then you get, like, the Master Cycle or whatever.
Nothing. And then you have to kind of, like, work your way up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was really hard. Like, going through those, like, different areas. Because I remember I started it, and like you said, you have nothing. And then I was like, what? And then I think you have to get through, like, the first 12 trials, and then you can, like, actually save.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think I died on, like, the 11th one. I was like, dude, fuck this.
And then you deleted the game.
The new meme of 2020. And then I deleted the game.
I'm
going
to download this 50 game. Deleted.
I'm gonna play Spider-Man. I'm gonna, like, not even shoot my web and just fall and die and be like, delete. But yeah, I am. Like I said, I'm excited for Elden Ring. From Software Games, dude. I don't know why, but they just have, like, such a place in my heart, just because those are the games that are, like, yeah, they're not graphically, like, insane or whatever, but, like, those, you are rewarded, and when you beat a boss, you're like, dude, I could kill anyone right now. Like, I can do anything. Like, I remember in Dark Souls 3, they had the Nameless King.
Oh my god.
And that, I remember how much of a pain in the ass he was. And I remember when I beat him, I was like, dude, who wants to mess with me? Like, come on, anybody. Like, bring it on. And then
I did not like – I just felt like he was cheap.
He was. He was very cheap.
The dragon was pretty cheap, I think.
Like, yeah.
Normally with – from bosses and stuff, it's like they're usually pretty good, and they're hard, but when you beat them, you're like, yes, this is so rewarding. But yeah, there's every once in a while there's a couple bosses that you fight that are just, I'm like, dude, this is stupid, this is cheap.
Yeah, I know, like, there was one of the DLCs, I think the Ring City,
yeah,
that it brought on a boss, some dragon boss, which apparently outnumbered the Nameless King and how hard he was to beat, which was pretty crazy. And then, like, I don't know if you guys, have you played Sekiro?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Did you guys beat it? I haven't beat it yet. I think I just got past the bull. Yo, but that guy, the first guy you fight, the first, what are they called when you have executions, but they're called something. Like, the people that you fight are called something. They're not, like, shoguns, but they're called, like...
Samurai?
Is that what it's called? It said, like, something execution. But that dude who's on this horse, like, when he comes out, dude.
Oh, yeah.
That was so intimidating.
Yeah, that was a really cool fight. That's, like, when you really learn how to use the grappling hook and stuff.
Yeah. He was like, my name is blah. I was like, oh, my God.
Did you just get that game, Sekiro?
No, I've had it. I've actually had it for, I think I got it on launch.
Okay.
And then I kept playing it, and I just couldn't, like, just because I'm so used to, like, you know, I played Demon Souls, Dark Souls. I skipped two, and I played three. Yeah, it's so different. It's, like, weird how mobile you are. And the whole, like, posture thing is something to get, like, really. Yeah,
it takes a while, but once it clicks and you get it,
yeah,
God, it's cool. Like, it's
so rewarding, cool. Yeah.
It's my favorite From game. Like, Bloodborne was probably my favorite.
Oh, dude. Oh, my God. And I,
yeah, Sekiro, man. Once, like, it did take me a while. It took me about 5 or 6 hours of Sekiro. Because I was just trying to hack away, and I was like, dude, this is not working. And then I got it down, the posture thing. And
the parries.
And the parry, the posture and the parry. It super clicked with me, and I just was like, yeah, dude, this game friggin' rules.
Yeah.
I'm really hoping that Elden Ring is, I don't even know what that's going to be about.
I don't know.
I'm here for it, though.
Yeah. I know, yeah.
Whatever it is.
My body is ready.
I really want them to do a Bloodborne 2, but I don't know if they'll ever do it.
See, and that's the thing, like Sekiro, like if it's I mean, it got game of the year, but they probably won't make a second one. Like, it wasn't exclusive, right? Like Bloodborne, it was for everything, right?
It went on
Switch, but
I have heard that this is kind of off topic, but going back to Assassin's Creed, the next one is called Assassin's Creed Ragnarok, and it's going to be focused on it's going to come out, it's going to be around like when the PS5 comes out. And it's going to be based on, like, Vikings, which will be...
Like, kind of like the Norse mythology?
Yeah. Huh?
I haven't heard... I think it's been a rumor for a while.
Yeah.
The Assassin's Creed game this year. So, yeah, it'd probably be launch of the new consoles next year.
That would be...
That'd be wild.
So sick, dude.
But, yeah. I haven't played Assassin's Creed since, Black Flag, I think.
Dude, okay. So, I tell everybody this who tells them that, because that was the last one I played.
Yeah.
And that's my favorite one. And Odyssey blows that one out of the water.
Sweet.
Like, Nick, have you played them? Like, Origins or Odyssey?
I've heard how great they are, but I don't know why I haven't played them yet.
Dude, I haven't played Origins, but I know that's, like, the start of, like, the mechanics of what Odyssey was like. But, dude, those games. The story is, like, not, like, the craziest.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not, like, you know, that in-depth because it has, like, it always reminds me of Mass Effect, how, like, Mass Effect always has those weird, like, character animations where they'll be talking and then, like, they won't even be looking at you or whatever, you know? Like, it's just so weird. But the gameplay is really good.
Yeah, it has some creepy effects.
I think Mass Effect was the last Mass Effect I played.
Oh, dude. Oh, 2 and 3 are sick. But I think it was Assassin's Creed. What was the one after Black Friday?
I think it was Unity.
Unity. I think they had like some weird like glitches where people's faces like weren't animating and you could like see the bone and skin underneath.
Oh yeah.
They did that to Resident Evil 2, man. Those people did those mods to Resident Evil 2. They like made like facial expressions like times 500%. And so they did that one where that dude's head gets crushed and it's just like blood goes everywhere.
Like every time they mod like Mr. X or whatever, I think there's one like Thomas the Train Engine was coming after you.
Yeah. They made one where he was like really tiny.
Yeah. It was like, I think the best though was like back in the day, it was like Skyrim at the very beginning. It was like Macho Man Randy Savage. He's like,
Macho Man Randy Savage, the dragon. Oh my God. I still remember when that game released, dude. Every time like November 11th comes around, I'm always like, whatever year it is, I'm like 8 years ago. Like in 2019, I was like, oh man, 8 years ago, I was at GameStop waiting for Skyrim.
My life changed
like,
forever.
It's like any sort of meme is like when someone passes out and they wake up and you're like in the cart with that dude. He's like, you're gonna.
Yeah. I remember when I used to be an adventurer, but then I took an arrow to the knee.
That was like where memes were born.
That was the first meme.
That was the first meme. And then something about like a sweet roll. Yeah. I don't remember what it was. I don't remember what he said.
I remember Troll 6 and just like, I remember like, I think we were hanging out with Mark or something, and we were all just like paused and we're like, I think we're gonna go home and play Skyrim. We're gonna go home.
I remember we did that, yeah, because we were like, it was like a competition. I remember we'd all meet at Dugan's house and we'd be like, dude, where are you at? And I remember like the second day Dugan was like, oh, I'm already like finished the companions. And I was like, what's the companions? And he's like, oh man, you turned to a werewolf. I was like, holy shit. That game was crazy. Because I remember you and Dugan were playing it like at GameStop because they had it in that little like arcade cabinet thing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And you're like, dude, come over here, Trey. And I was like, no, fuck you guys. I was like, I don't want to ruin it. I was like, I'm the first one in line. And then I don't think there was that many people, because I remember it came out the same day that Black Ops 2 came out. They were like the two releases.
Yeah.
Yep. They both came out 11/11/11, and so that was the two like major games that released. And I don't remember it being busy from what I remember. Like, there wasn't that many people. I think there was only like 10 people.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Which was kind of insane. I don't even know if GameStop still does midnight releases.
I don't probably know. I haven't been to one. I think Halo Reach might have been. No, I went to the Nintendo Switch midnight launch at Best Buy. That's the last one I've done.
Oh, okay.
Zelda. But
yeah, I don't even.
That's the last one I've done.
Yeah, everything else I just have bought, like, you know, either I don't, you know, buy either after it comes out or.
Yeah. I try to buy it mostly digital now, unless I just find like a really nice deal for physical.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. See, I do like the opposite. I try to buy physical. That way, if like I don't like it, I can just resell it.
True.
And I'll only buy digital if it's like on sale.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
That way, if I don't like it, I didn't lose too much. But if I buy like a physical copy, I can just be like, hey, dude. And like, I think GameStop now, they have like a thing where you can buy like a new game, and if you don't like it, you can still return it within 48 hours and get your full money back.
Oh, wow.
So, which is pretty nice, because I mean, you know, they've never had anything like that. They would just be like, oh, yeah, well, even though you spent $60, here's $20 for your brand new Modern Warfare. You're like, oh, wow.
And they gave me like $2 for it.
That's just offensive.
I think that was the last time I traded in a game at GameStop. I was like, never again.
I did that to, you said what?
Not going to be burned again by them.
Yeah. You won't get me twice. They did that for fucking Destiny. It was either Destiny or Destiny 2, I think. I was like, I had all these like PS4 games, and I was like, dude, I'm just going to get rid of these things. And then they were like, hey, do you want this Destiny CD? And I was like, no, I want to trade it in to get credit. And they're like, it's worth 3 cents. and I was like, oh. And they're like, are you sure you don't want to keep it? And I was like, yeah, no, I don't want it. And they're like, okay. And then just increased it 3 cents. And I was like, okay. I mean, I don't know what you guys are going to do with it, but that just like made me laugh so hard. But I remember the last time that I went to GameStop was back in April. And I got rid of Mortal Kombat 11,
yeah,
Mario Odyssey, and Mario Kart 8, and I got like $120.
Oh,
jeez. I guess Nintendo games always kind of
value. I got like, I think like yeah, like, because Mortal Kombat was like 41, and then like Odyssey was like 41, and then I think like Mario Kart 8 was like 38, so it was like around $120. And I was like, damn, dude. So that was, I think I used that to pay off Modern Warfare and Pokemon.
Okay.
Oh, nice.
So like the last games I've been playing, I paid for, but paid like way ahead of time. So that's really nice. And like I said, that's why I like having physical copies, is because if like once I don't have, like, play them anymore, I can reuse the value to kind of put towards something else.
I kind of had like the mentality, especially with, since my son was born, like, I just try to keep everything. That way, whenever he if he wants to play games, I've got like a huge
backup. Which he better. Right? He's destined.
So I guess to wrap things up, topic of the week was kind of like your gaming resolution. So I guess I'll go first. I just want to play more games this year. Like, we're going over like the game.
Going
through the whole year. There's so much stuff that I missed. I mean, obviously money comes is a big factor into it, because I mean, it's hard to
pump right
$60, you know, every couple weeks or whatever, but
mm-hmm.
Yeah, I just want to play more important stuff, I guess.
I actually want to play less games this year. Or just not play less time wise, but focus more on singular games instead of just beating them and moving on to the next one after I finish. Because that's kind of what I've been doing the past like year or two, is I just finish one and go straight to the next one.
Yeah. Does it make things a blur to where you kind of forget what you did?
Kind of.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, I beat Sekiro in, you know, February, whenever it came out. And we were talking about Game of the Year last week. And at first, I didn't remember it because it was so long ago. And I stopped playing it in March. But I don't know.
Dang. Was it a long game?
I'd say it's like a little shorter than normal Dark Souls games.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't even know how far I am. Do you know how far I would be if I'm by the bull? Probably not that far.
Probably like 20% through.
Okay. Oh, damn. I still got a ways. That's kind of intimidating.
Yeah. It's not.
Yeah, it only gets harder.
Yeah. I figured. I guess my game resolution would be, my problem is I have too many games that I start at once.
Yeah.
And kind of like you guys, I would rather, well, kind of like what Nit said, I would rather play less games that are more, valuable when it comes to like story and like, I can like immerse myself in, like you, Harrison, you're playing The Witcher. So you're probably getting really into that.
Yeah.
And I would be fine. I would be fine being into a game that's like, you know, consumes like 4 months out of the year. Like, and Odyssey, I mean, 90 hours and I'm not even like, you know, I mean, I beat the main story, I beat the first story arc, and I'm in the second episode of the second story arc, so I'll probably finish at 110 hours. That's good to me.
Yeah, I mean, that's like
Skyrim. If I can find more games that are like that, that would be my resolution, is to play less games but spend more time on each individual game.
Yeah.
Instead of bouncing back and forth and getting bored with one and starting another one when I haven't finished it, so.
Yeah.
Because like Nick said, like it just makes it blurry and then it's not memorable.
Yeah.
So.
Right.
Well, yeah.
Cool. All right. Well, yeah, I think that's probably going to wrap it up. It's been, Trey asked earlier, he was like, how long do they usually last? I was like, about an hour.
An hour.
just kind of depends. Like the game of the year was pretty long.
Yeah.
They're usually about an hour, but.
It's always the ones that we don't have any news to talk about. Yeah, but they always go on stuff.
It's because we're like able to be like creative and just talk about whatever we want.
Yeah. So yeah, just appreciate everyone listening and stuff. If you guys, you know, we always say it every week, if you want to email in and just ask any questions, it doesn't have to be game related, you can ask whatever you want. I think eventually, if we get a bunch of people to email, I would probably drop maybe the topic of the week and then just do like email.
Yeah.
I feel like if people emailed in, that would kind of create a topic that we can kind of, you know, spend, you know, some time talking about that. But for now, we'll still do the topics and stuff.
Right.
Just try to kind of think of it over the week or whatever. But yeah, just appreciate everyone listening. First episode of the new year. Like I said before, at the beginning of the show, we'll go back to Sundays every week, or you know, doing the show every Sunday. And yeah, you can follow my brother on his, you can go listen to his music. I'll have everything linked in the show notes stuff. I stream sometime on Twitch, Atomic Reptar 92. Trey, do you stream or anything?
I don't do anything. I literally listen. And I was like, man, I need to join in on this because this is, I don't have anybody to talk to games about. So I was like, this is an outlet.
Yeah. So yeah, we'll, I mean, last episode we had people on. I'm sure we'll have you on again.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. Well, whenever it'd be a pleasure. You want to
come on. Whenever you get time. I mean, I don't know your work schedule.
I literally don't work Sunday and Mondays. Those are my days off. So if you guys, you know, have a, you know, if you have somebody you wanted to get on, or you guys just,
yeah,
whenever, dude, even if you wanted to, I could literally do every Sunday. It's whatever you guys want to do.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we enjoyed, having you and Adam on the last couple of weeks. So.
Hell yeah. How many people can you have in one thing?
I don't know, actually.
Probably a pretty good amount.
I'm assuming it lets me invite people. So, I don't know if there's a limitation.
This is for businesses, so you can, I'm assuming you can have a bunch.
I know it said like 100, but I don't know if that would be like 100 people like video chatting, because that'd be, who's talking?
Yeah.
That'd be pretty crazy.
Actually, I think we used this for a training, and there were like 80 people.
Jeez.
Oh, wow. And they were all like video?
Yeah, they're all video. It just shows you the video of who's talking, and it'll switch off.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but
I was wondering why it kept switching between you two guys. I was like, maybe it just like it's just doing that to create.
It's pretty cool because you can add like I was showing Nick. You can add like if there's a document or something that I want you to see, I can add it on the screen and then you can see, then everybody can see it. So yeah.
Oh wow.
So yeah, I don't know if Skype works that way, but I'm assuming it's pretty similar. But
yeah, I don't know. I'm not too familiar with this stuff, but I mean, pretty easy.
But yeah, appreciate everyone listening in. Podcast usually goes live every Monday, and then I usually put like the video form on YouTube on Tuesdays, and then live every Sunday at 8:30.
Hell yeah. Well, thanks for having me, guys.
Yeah.
Thanks for coming on, Trey.
Hell yeah, guys. Well, you guys have a good night, all right?
All right, yeah. You too, man.
All right, bye, y'all.
Later. See ya.